dams made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing,
Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church. Members, your expected guests, thank you for joining us today. And if you're viewing us online, we know you have many choices out there. We're glad that you're viewing our service today. Thank you for joining us for worship. I'd like to begin this morning open with a scripture from Deuteronomy 33, beginning with verse 26. There is no one like the God of Israel. He rides across the heavens to help you, across the skies in majestic splendor. The eternal God is your refuge, and his everlasting arms are under you. Instead of taking your sedative before you watch the news at night, open your Bible, read a verse of scripture like that. Knowing that we are held in the everlasting arms of God is a great, great promise. It's a great joy to know. Join us as we worship. What a fellowship, what a joy to find you leading by the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine leading by the everlasting arms. Leading, safe and secure from all alarms. Leading by the everlasting.
Take my feet and let Folks, aren't we grateful and thankful that Jesus is the giver of life? Amen? Amen? You know, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through Him. Paul writes in Ephesians 2, 4, but because of His great love for us. Think that through. His great, not just His love for us, which is enough, but His great love for each and every one of us, that God, who is rich in mercy, aren't we grateful and thankful that He is rich in mercy? God, who is rich in mercy, has made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. even when we wanted nothing to do with him. And it is by grace that we have been saved. Amen. Folks, we have reason, we have meaning, we have purpose, we have life, and that's all because of Jesus. He makes all of that possible. You know the verse, Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, kind of been our focus verse this last month during this time before we enter in time of a message. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. So let me ask you, have there been some things that are kind of anxious right now in your life? Some things maybe heavy, needing some wisdom, some guidance, some direction? Hey, let's go to the Lord. Let's go to the Lord as a church, as families, as individuals, whether you want to stand and pray, sit, kneel, pray by yourself, pray with your family, pray with someone, pray over someone. You're at home watching, the same thing. Let's spend this time in prayer, and then I'll close us out. You respond. You pray. Let me lead us as a church also in this. 1 Timothy chapter 2 says this: I urge you then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior. Folks, in 31 days, our nation, we're going to be having to go to many elections. Cast our vote, and we as the church must be leading the way and praying for our nation. Amen? Because it's scriptural. It says this is good and pleases. Let's pray for our nation at this time. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Father, our loyalty, first and foremost, is to you, the Lamb that was slain for the forgiveness of our sins. And so, Lord, I pray for our nation. Lord, it begins with us as your church. God, may we, your church, get down on our knees, and may we, from this day forward, continue to pray for our nation, for the many elections that are going to be taking place. Father, you're in control. You've got all this, and we turn this over to you, but we know we have a part, a responsibility. And God, we've gathered today to hear from you, and we look forward to what we need to hear from you through your word. Help me speak your words and help me get out of your way. God, also during this time, we have lifted up requests and concerns and worries. There are many here. Lord, there are concerns, there are questions. There are uncertainties. There's places they need wisdom and direction. And God, thank you for already being at work and help all of us be able to hear from you and to know, Lord, I trust you no matter what the answer, whether it's yes, no, or wait. because we know that your will, your plan, your ways, your thoughts are not ours. And we trust your plans in all things, and we turn this over to you. God, speak to us. We look forward to what you want to say, and I pray this in your Son's name. Amen. And you may be seated. And if you have a kid, a child up through the fifth grade, and they would like to go to children's church, they can. If you're visiting with us, we do have children's church at this time, first through fifth grade, or they can stay in here with us just as well. And while they're doing that, let's all turn, power up, turn on, slide over, whatever you need to do, to Galatians chapter 4. We're going to be in Galatians today, going to finish our series that I Choose Joy. Okay? I Choose Joy. So how's it been going this week?
Great.
Awesome. Thank you, Candy. Okay? It's been going great for Candy. Did y'all know that? That's awesome. And I know it has been for many of you, but I also know that for some of us, it maybe has been a kind of a tough week, a challenging week. I can relate. I had a meeting this week with this thing called E. coli. I wouldn't want that on anyone. Mine, even my worst enemy. And I didn't find that out until yesterday. My doctor called me. Because I thought it was just food poisoning. I was trying to, you know, food poisoning, but he called me yesterday afternoon and said, no, Marty, you know, when your doctor calls you at home on a Saturday, you're like, oh, I better get this phone call. And it's him personally. He says, you got a strain of E. coli. Okay, that makes sense. Still miserable, but that makes sense. And E. coli introduced me to back spasms and back pain and all of that. And after, you know, being someone that's had two back surgeries and you start getting back pains and back spasms, that's not. So, no, I've not had a whole lot of good this week. But I'm still choosing joy because my joy, your joy, our joy is in the Lord. Amen? You're so convincing. Hey, online folks, is your joy in the Lord? Yep, they just responded. Good. Our joy is in the Lord. Amen, church? Amen. We're going to see that today. We're going to finish this series, I Choose Joy. Because here's the deal. As a Christian, okay, as someone who's put their faith and trust and hope and loyalty in Jesus, listen, I don't believe we lose our joy. Okay? I don't believe we lose it. We misplace it. We forget about it. And here's why I mean that. Okay, and we addressed it a little bit the last couple weeks. See, when we give our life to Christ, we trust Him as Lord and Savior of our life. And I love how Paul says this in Ephesians chapter 1:13. And he says, when we give our life to Christ, when we hear the message of the gospel, okay? When we hear the message of the gospel and we surrender to the message of the gospel of Jesus, of who Jesus was and what he did for us, that he died for our sins on the cross, and the fact that we're sinners in need of a Savior, and Jesus is the only one that can forgive our sins and saves us from our sins. When we do that, the Bible says, you know, we hear the message of the gospel, we believe or trust in the message of the gospel, and then it says, then we are sealed with a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance. It says we're sealed with the Holy Spirit. See, when you gave your life to Christ, immediately at that point, you received the Holy Spirit, okay? The role, one of many roles of the Holy Spirit, okay, and we looked at this the last couple weeks, is there's a fruit of the Holy Spirit working, a product of the Holy Spirit working in of our life. Guess what? One of those, in Galatians chapter 5, is joy. Says the fruit of the Spirit is joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, and self. There's nine of them. It's not an optional. I'll pick this one and this one. Listen, it's all there. Some of them are easy for us and some of them are harder, but they're all there for us, and we just misplace them. We forget them. And we do that, which we're going to look at today, we do that for many different reasons. So let me ask you this, okay? What has gotten or what gets in the way from you experiencing the joy of the Lord? We're going to answer that question in a little bit, but we're going to look at another story in the Bible, Galatians chapter 4, because Paul says this very statement. Now, I have the NIV, and that's what I preach through every Sunday, NIV, and it's an older version. It's the 84 version. And in Galatians chapter 4, look at Galatians chapter 4, verse 15. Okay, we're going to read all of it, but specifically we're going to look at 15 real quick, and then we'll go back. Okay, 4:15, okay, Paul's writing to the churches in Galatia. He says, what has happened to all your joy? What has happened to all your joy? See, we can relate. Maybe not right now. But there are times in our lives, there are situations, there are circumstances, there are things that cause us to misplace, to forget the joy of the Lord. So Galatians chapter 4, let's understand this, okay? To understand this helps us understand why he says that, okay? Paul, obviously writing the letter Galatians to the churches in Galatia. Galatia is an area in what is now modern day Turkey, which that's a large, massive area. And so he's writing to the churches in Galatia. Okay, Paul went on primarily three missionary journeys where he would start in Jerusalem and go travel and then come back to Jerusalem. I mean, he did a lot of traveling, but there's primarily three. Okay, the churches in Galatia were planted, by Paul, and it's around Acts 13 and 14. And we looked at that a couple weeks ago with Paul and Barnabas and what they experienced. And so Acts chapter 13, 14 would be Paul's first mission, a little bit of description of his first missionary journey. So it's around late 47, 48, 49 AD, okay? And then this, okay, so he goes and plants these churches, okay, in Galatia, which is they're going to be churches for the Gentiles, okay? Not Jews, for Gentiles, okay? And we're going to see why that's important here in just a little bit. And so he's planting these churches. Well, he's gotten word about what he taught them and what they are now doing and believing now has him upset. And so what we have now in Galatians is he's writing back to them. He's not there. He's writing to these churches. And in chapters 1, 2, and 3, okay, he writes and kind of with some force and some sternness. And then all of a sudden he gets to chapter 4 and the personal side comes out, okay? Because he's invested in these people, okay? He spent time with these people. He's started and planted these churches, so he cares deeply for them. And all of a sudden in Galatians chapter 4, okay? Galatians chapter 4, and we're going to see what happens. So obviously he asks us this question, what has happened to all your joy? Obviously their joy is gone. That means they had it. When did they have it? Why did they have it? And so what has happened now? So Galatians chapter 4, we're starting verse 12, okay? He says, I plead with you, or some of your translations might say, I beg, okay? So obviously, I plead, I beg. He's sincere, he's earnest, okay? I plead with you, brothers, meaning brothers and sisters in Christ. I plead with you, brothers, become like me, for I became like you. You have done me no wrong. As you know, it was because of an illness that I first preached the gospel to you. Even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn. Instead, you welcomed me as if I were an angel of God, as if I were Christ Jesus himself. Let me stop there. Okay, we don't know what the illness was. And understanding in this time, but even today in third world countries, and if you've ever been to a third world country, there are many other countries outside the U.S., if someone had, whether they were born that way or it occurred, whether it be a physical illness, whether it be for him, obviously, he's got something on the outside, okay, that makes it, whatever that might be, because he says there in 14, even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt and scorn. In other countries, if somebody had an illness or there was a physical condition, okay, listen, they're not taken care of like they are here, okay? They're not taking care of people like we take care of people here, right? The government helps out, churches help out, people help out. They are scorned. They are looked down in other countries. And he said, when I showed up, you took care of me. You welcomed me. You loved me. Even though the society and other people around, they looked at me and looked down at me. You, church, you took care of me. You were there for me. You went above and beyond. So we see there's some seriousness, but some heart in this. Because he says, even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me like the rest of the community, okay? You welcomed me in, and because of that, I got to share with you the gospel. And because of that, we planted churches. So we see, he says, you did above and beyond than anyone else. And I got to share with you this wonderful message of Jesus. But then he says, but something happened. Something happened. He says, so what has happened to all your joy? What's happened? Why is there no more joy? Well, go to Acts 13. Because here's what we know in Acts 13. Go to Acts 13. Because Acts 13, remember, was their first missionary journey and would have been a description. In Acts 13, we see this joy. Okay, some translations might say rejoice. Mine will say glad. There'll be joy. Acts 13, 48. This would have been when the church in Galatia was started. Okay, and he says in Acts 13, 48, when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. See, when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad. There was rejoicing. There was joy. What was there rejoicing in? What was the joy in? It was in Jesus. Amen? It was in Jesus. So what's going on? So go back to Galatians 4. Why are they now, as we see in verse 15, what has happened to all your joy? Well, here's what's happened. The Judaizers have come in. See, one of the emphasis of Galatians, see, the Judaizers come in and they say, listen, we know what Paul said. Paul said is, you know, faith alone, grace alone, Jesus alone. But that's not it. Paul, that's not correct what Paul said. The Judaizers came in and said, it's Jesus plus. Okay? It's Jesus plus circumcision. It's Jesus plus obeying the Mosaic law. It's Jesus plus obeying the rituals, the customs. Okay? It's all of that. It's Jesus plus all of this. And so they've come in. They're false teachers. They've come in and told the churches in Galatia, what Paul told you was not correct. It's not faith alone, grace alone, Jesus alone. It's Jesus plus. And so what Paul is addressing them, he says, you welcomed me, okay? You were warm to me. No one else would. You took care of me. But now you reject me. Because look what he says in verse 16. Have I now become your enemy by telling you the truth? See, we were friends. We were close. You invited me in. You took care of me. And now you want nothing to do with me. Now you won't even welcome me. Matter of fact, you look in verse at the end of verse 15. I can testify that if you could have done so, you would have torn out your eyes and given them to me. Okay? Now, that's a figure of speech, but we see the heart for these people, for Paul, and what they used to be. Where's the joy gone? What's happened is they have begun to believe these false teachers. And so Paul is trying to correct them and saying, listen, salvation is in grace alone, faith alone, because of Jesus alone. Amen? It was then, and it is now, because Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through him. Church, and we said, amen. So all of a sudden, they are going back or being misled by this works, by this effort. You've got to do this. And now they view him as an enemy. And what we see, they have lost their joy. Now, they've misplaced their joy. So let me ask you, how do we misplace our joy, church? How do we misplace our joy? See, the Galatian church was listening to all the wrong voices. They were listening to the voices of the Judaizers, and they weren't listening to the truth and the promises that God had spoken through Paul. They were going back to this belief that you have to earn and work for salvation. Listen, what voices are we listening to? Who do we listen to that causes us to misplace or forget the joy that we have that's in the Lord? How else do we misplace our joy? We misplace our joy when we aren't close to God and we take our eyes off of Jesus. Listen, when we start taking our eyes off of Jesus, okay, we quit spending time in the Word of God. We quit spending time in the Word of God. We quit making church an important part of our life, of our family. Yeah. We quit spending time in prayer. Yeah. It's easy to misplace, forget the joy. How else do we misplace our joy? Well, we misplace our joy when we let the circumstances of life get the best of us. Now, I'm not downplaying your circumstances or circumstances, but if we're not careful, the circumstances of life will get the best of us and will cause us to forget or misplace this joy that we have that is in Jesus Christ. Amen? But the circumstances, what else? Well, here's how else we misplace joy. We misplace joy by shame. Shame is looking back at our past. Hey, we've all got a past. But as a believer, as a Christian, are we grateful and thankful for forgiveness? Amen? Are we thankful and grateful that God didn't give up on us? Amen? Yeah. But if we're not careful, we can listen to the lies of shame. We can listen to lies or be focused on worry and anxiety. Anybody have any struggles with that lately? Worry and anxiety, which is looking at our current situation. Not downplaying what your current situation is. But if our eyes are on that and not on constantly the reminders of the Lord, it's easy to misplace and forget the joy. Or how about fear? Fear, or which is looking at our future. Maybe right now our future doesn't look so promising, so good. Can I remind you of a wonderful passage in Isaiah? Isaiah chapter 41, if you're struggling right now with some fear. Isaiah 41:10, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. And I will strengthen you, and I will help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Amen? Man, aren't those great promises and words from the Lord? But if we're not careful, we'll let fear, we'll let worry, we'll let anxiety, we'll let circumstances cause us to misplace this joy. How else do we misplace joy, believers? Sin. Man, let's just be honest. Sin causes us to misplace and robs us of the joy. Psalm 51 is David's repentance, confession of his sin with Bathsheba. And in that, you hear, in a sense, him weeping in brokenness. And he cries out, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation." Folks, repentance is necessary for you and I as believers. It's necessary. Man, sin robs us of our joy. Sin separates us from the source of our joy. Counterfeit. Our world is really good about selling counterfeits, is it not? Hey, if you just do this, have this, buy this, accomplish this, accumulate this, then man, that's it, and everything will be fine. Or our world says, hey, follow your heart. You be you. I guess that's the new one. Really? As a believer, as a Christian, we're imitators, we're followers of Jesus. Amen? Because our heart is going to lead us down some wrong roads, because it's our heart. We are followers of Jesus. If we're not careful, we can also allow counterfeits to get in the way. Counterfeits, okay, things that disguise themselves, or we think that, man, the promises that they make, man, if I can just get this, have this, accumulate this, okay, then, man, then I will ultimately find joy. But you and I know, that's not going to happen. Folks, the enemy loves to convince us of these counterfeits. Anything. He will do anything to keep our eyes off of Jesus and the joy that Jesus alone provides. Speaking of which, we got to also remember, we misplace this joy. We forget about this joy because there's a real spiritual battle going on. There's a real spiritual battle. When you think about all the words in the Bible that describe Satan, not a single one of them is any good. liar, accuser, a thief. I mean, multiple others. None of those are positive. None of those are good. Listen, Satan can't steal our joy, but you know what? He can sure make it so easy that we can't find or have access to it. Go over to the right, Galatians, Ephesians. Go to Ephesians 6:11. Okay, go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11. This whole section is about the full armor of God. And notice what Paul writes to the churches in Ephesus. He says, you got to be strong in the Lord. And in order to do that, because he says in Ephesians 6:10, he says, finally, be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. So if you and I want to be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power, it says, put on the full armor of God. And here's why. We need to be strong. We've got to put on the full armor of God. And here's why. Because so you can stand against the devil's schemes. Again, another word that is not a good description. Folks, Satan can't steal our joy, but he's going to do whatever he can to scheme us, convince us, to cause us. But at the end of the day, it's us. Let's not give him too much credit. We're the ones that choose. We're the ones that misplace. We're the ones that forget. We're the ones that go back. And that's what's going on. Here's what's going on here. Paul is writing to them. Please don't go back. Don't go back to what you used to believe, to what they are saying, to what you used to, because it was nothing but, in a sense, slavery for you. Don't go back to this old lifestyle, okay? There's no promise. There's no hope in that. Just human effort. There's no freedom. There's no rejoicing. There's no truth in that. I heard this great story. Russell Moore is the president of the Ethics and Religious Liberty of the Southern Baptist Convention. And he shares a story when he and his wife adopted two of their boys. And I was so in tune to the story, I can't remember. I think it was Russia. I think they adopted two boys from Russia. But I know it's somewhere one of those countries over there. So they were, the two boys were in an orphanage over there, which is sadly, they're deplorable circumstances, situation. So, and of course, if they're adopting some boys from Russia, it's not a one trip. There's more than likely been several trips and several thousands of dollars for this transaction. That's how Russia sees it to take place. And he was sharing with how when he and his wife went over for the final time to get their two boys, all the paperwork, everything was done. These two boys were going to be theirs. These two boys had never seen the sun. These two boys had never had clean clothes. These two boys had never been outside. They'd never experienced the wind. They'd never been in a car. They'd never experienced the unconditional love they were getting ready to receive from Russell and his wife. So when the boys were placed in the car with their new clothes and their new parents in this car on their way to the airport, the boys were shaking. And as they're driving off from this orphanage in these conditions, the boys are shaking and they turn around with this, their arms, they want to go back because that's all they've ever known. In their eyes, what they see with them in the car and ahead of them is unfamiliar and scary. And even these deplorable, in their mind, these deplorable situation, deplorable conditions they were under was better than what they thought was ahead of them. They had no idea the joy that they, as we say in Oklahoma, fixing to experience. Ultimately, all because of Jesus. Folks, may we not turn back. May we not look back. Because here's the deal. How do we find, relocate this joy that we've misplaced? okay? Or not forget this anymore. Here's one thing is this. Folks, joy happens when we remember the promises of God. We must not forget the promises of God. Amen? So what are they? Think about it. What are the promises of God that have helped you, that have encouraged you, that have challenged you, that have comforted you, that have strengthened you? That God is always good, that God is faithful, that God is dependable, that God is reliable, that God is trusting, that God is gracious, that God loves us unconditional, and that God is forgiving. Amen? Aren't those wonderful promises that we have from God? We must not forget them. If we focus on the circumstances, if we focus on the things, if we focus on the what ifs, if we focus on the fear, the worry, and the anxiety, those things are real, they happen. But if we stay focused on them and not Him and not His Word, we will misplace the joy. We will forget about the joy. But church, we must remember the wonderful promises of God for His children, that I will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen? That's how we don't misplace and forget. Second of all, we must continually abide, or some translations, remain in Him, and not abide and remain in our feelings. That word is used 11 times in John 15. So think John 15. So John 15, he's with his disciples the night of his arrest. He's called out the betrayer. He's called out the denier. He's getting ready to be arrested and then crucified. So he's having this meal, this time, this teaching moment with his disciples. And he says 11 times in John 15, disciples, in a sense, I'm going to paraphrase, I know you don't understand what's going on. I know you're worried, but remain in me, abide in me, remain in me, remain in me, remain in me. Listen, he says the same thing to you and I. How are we not going to misplace and forget this wonderful joy? It's church, we must continually abide and remain in Jesus and not our feelings and circumstances and the outcome and what's going on. Amen? We must. Jesus said in John 15:5, apart from me, you can do nothing. Because when we are abiding, we are a better listener to Him instead of the reasons that we just talked about. And when we abide and remain, we are reminded of the promises and the character of God. We must continually remain and abide and spend time with Him. We must continually remember His, or rediscover, or for some of us, discover. Because some people's idea of God is punishing and mean. No. Discover the promises of God. And the third thing and last thing is this. Folks, we must remember that Jesus is greater than your circumstances. Amen? No, seriously, do you believe that? I mean, we've all experienced, every single one, it doesn't matter the age. We've all experienced circumstances like never before. I mean, do we really believe that Jesus is greater than these circumstances? Not downplaying the COVID and all the effects of it at all. It's real. It's there. It's happening. But folks, we got to remember that Jesus is greater than the circumstances. I found this quote. It says, we can't know Jesus and lack joy. We can't follow Jesus and lack joy. We can't be united with Jesus and lack joy because it is biblically, logically, and theologically impossible. Aren't you thankful and grateful for Jesus, church? It doesn't matter. It doesn't mean that everything's going to be easy. It doesn't mean that we're just going to be smiling and laughing and through everything. That's not what it's talking about. However, because our life is marked with a confidence that Jesus is greater and more satisfying than anything else this world has to offer. He is. He is greater and He is more satisfying than anything this world. And listen, man, this world is offering you and I some wonderful things, but none of them compare to what Jesus has to offer. Amen? Because you know what? Jesus is greater than death. Jesus is greater than our problems. Jesus is greater than our sin. He is greater than our doubt. He is greater than our past. He is greater than our plans. He is greater than our mistakes. He is greater than our fear. He is greater than our worries. He is greater than our circumstances. He is greater than our anxieties. Jesus is greater. Because Jesus says this in John 16:33. So he's getting ready to be arrested. He says, I have told you these things so that you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Aren't you grateful and thankful that Jesus has overcome the world? Amen? And it's because he has overcome the world, folks, and because we have put, you have put your trust and your hope in him, you can live, and you and I can say with confidence, this is the day the Lord has made. And we will, no matter what's going on, we will rejoice and be glad in it. And because of Jesus, we can say, rejoice in the Lord. I'll say it again, rejoice. Because of Jesus, we can say, for the joy of the Lord is my strength. Because of Jesus, we can say, consider pure joy, my brothers, when we face trials of many kinds. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance, and perseverance must finish its work so that you and I are mature and not lacking anything. And it's because of Jesus that you and I can say, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, and I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. Is the sovereign Lord your strength or something else? Because I'm just going to tell you, if something or someone else is your strength, I'm just going to give you a heads up if you haven't figured it out yet. They're going to let you down because they're human. They're imperfect. There's an ending. There is not with Jesus. Amen. The study we looked at last week, 2 Corinthians 8. Remember, the church in Macedonia and Corinth were in deplorable circumstances. Famine had ravaged them. Just the devastation of war had ravaged them. They had hardly anything. But remember what the Bible described the church in Macedonia? Remember how the Bible described them? As a bunch of people that were poor, poor, pitiful me. Woe is me. Isn't that what the Bible said last week? No, what did it say last week? Remember? The church in Macedonia was what with joy? Overflowing with. Their circumstances were awful, terrible. But yet they, the believers, we're still overflowing with joy. Habakkuk was getting ready to face the devastation and the destruction and the death of his people, but yet he could still say, I will rejoice in the Lord. The sovereign Lord is my strength. Listen, church, no matter what we are facing, we can face it because of the joy in the Lord. Amen. And because of the word of God, and because of the church, this is the day the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Let's pray. Father, forgive us. We're sorry when we put our hope in things, in people, and not ultimately in you. Father, forgive us when we look more to the world's answers, the world's solutions, than we turn to you. Father, forgive us when we think we've got it all together and we know what to do, and we don't turn to you. And Father, thank you. Thank you for forgiving us. God, I thank you today. I know for those that were here today and had misplaced their joy and forgotten the joy, that today it's been found. They discovered where they had placed it. And Lord, you've spoken to them. You've revealed to them the things that have gotten in their way. That have gotten in the way, the voices, the things that they have let to be more important than you. And I thank you that you've not given up on any single one of us. You've not given up on anything. And you're not finished. You're not finished with them, finished with us. There's more you want to do in them and more you want to do through them. And so, God, I just continue to pray. Lord, we turn on the news, we watch the news, we read the news, we see what's going on in our own life, and if we keep our eyes on that, man, it's so depressing and sad and frustrating and discouraging and even bouts of anger. But God, may we look to you. May we look in your word. May we abide in you. May we remain in you. May we obey you. May we depend upon you. May we rely on you. May we trust in you and you alone. And that no matter what we go through, no matter what we face, we are not facing it alone. And because of that, we can have joy. And Lord, no matter what we're facing, we know we have brothers and sisters in Christ. We have a church family that is lifting us up, that is encouraging us, that is helping us, that you have put in our life and our path for a reason. God, I thank you for this church, and I thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ that have helped me out in so many ways over the course of the 10 wonderful years my family and I have been here. And Lord, I thank you for putting me in their life and the ways you've used me in their life. God, I thank you that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And Lord, I pray today that someone will make the decision to trust in you as Savior and Lord. And I pray this in your son's name. Amen. We have a response time. Response is to respond what the Lord has said. May the Lord has spoken to you and said, hey, you've never given your life to Jesus, and today's the day of salvation. Maybe there's a prayer need. Maybe it's to come be a part of this church. Let's respond in song, respond in decision. I'm down front. You stand, you respond.
As who, oh Lord, could save themselves, their own souls could heal. Thy shame was deeper than the sea, your grace is deeper still. You alone can rescue, you alone can save. Out of death, to you alone belongs the highest praise. You, oh Lord, have made a way. The great divides you heal. For when our hearts far away, your love went further still. Yes, your love goes further still. You alone can rescue, you alone can save, you alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise.
That passage in Ephesians is another one of those great books. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, has made us alive with Christ. Amen. We've been made alive because of Christ. Hey, have a seat real quick. I'm going to give you some quick announcements. As I shared during the prayer time, in 31 days, we are going to be casting our vote for many different elections locally and nationally. And so myself and the prayer team, here's what we're asking the church. And as we see what Scripture says, we need to be praying about this specifically. And here's one way we want to see the church involved in this, okay? And as you leave, you want to be a part of this and what the prayer team has put together on our welcome center, which is out these doors. There's a stapled two pieces of paper, and it's just a prayer, practical prayer tips. And on it is a date. And so we're just asking our church to be praying. And so go pick one up. If you say, hey, I will do that. I will on a particular day at your convenience and what works best for you, I'll pray. And like I said, here's some practical tips. And on it's got a date. And that'll be the date that you will block out some time and specifically be praying for our nation and our leadership and everything that's going on. And so I want to highly encourage the church to be a part of that. So like I said, it's on the welcome table, and it'll have the date on it, and at that any time that day, you just set aside, you block it out to be praying for what will be coming up. And so we need to be doing that as a church. Let me highlight a few things. Hey, if you are a chairperson or a team leader of a committee or a team, or on staff, we've got a council meeting at 4:30. It's really for the purpose of calendaring through the rest of this year. So that's at 4:30. Also, there's a life chain today at 2:00. See Nancy Philpott if you got some questions. Senior adults have our monthly get together, Joy Lunch in the Fellowship Hall this Tuesday at noon. Wednesday, ministry for all different ages. 6:00, grief share starts. And then 6:15 is we got classes for all ages. Okay, there's a nursery available. If you're here serving or helping, or you want to attend one of the classes on Wednesday night, that is available for you as well. Ladies, this Wednesday starts the new Wednesday Bible study for you. If you've got questions, you can see my wife, Christy, Stacy Beal, Carmen Davis, or call the church office if you've got some questions about that. It's a new women's Bible study called Get Out of Your Head, and so by Jenny Allen. So see them. Deacons, we've got a meeting next Sunday at 5, and then there's a men's breakfast coming up in 3 weeks on a Saturday morning at 8:00 as well. Here's the other thing. Last week, the personnel committee presented a recommendation to you all. We passed it out, had a video put together. We had a Q&A on Wednesday night, and we had said that there would be a ballot-only vote this Sunday. And so if you are a member of our church, what I need for you to do, if you would raise your hand, here's what's going to happen. They're going to come in and they're going to hand you a ballot. And if you weren't here, like, what's this about? It's got the details. Okay. They'll hand this to you. And if you'll just vote yes or no, and then just fold it up. And as you leave, you can hand it to one of them. So if you'd raise your hand so they can see who you are and they can start handing those to you. Okay. So you vote, and as you leave, you fold it up and you hand it to one of them as you leave. And what that was about was changing my job description, adding a new job description for associate pastor. That new associate pastor would be Joe Allen Peck, and it would be creating an interim youth minister position, and that would be Brandon Martin. And we will let you know about that this week. Like I said, just as you leave, you just hand it, you vote, you fold it over, hand it to one of them as you leave this morning. And also on your way out, the black boxes by the doors is our offering boxes. And so again, I know on behalf of the pastor of the stewardship committee, thank you for your financial faithfulness, your continued financial faithfulness to the church, to the Lord, through the church as well. Let me let that finish up just real quick. Remember our verses for this school year, okay? Psalm 118:24, this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen? And Philippians 4:6-7, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present our requests to God. And our joy, no matter what, is in the Lord. Amen, church? You're dismissed. Have a great week. Thank you.
Good job, team.
Thanks, Dane. Thank you. I'll talk to you this week.